you.
Grace be to you.
And peace from God the Father.
And peace from God the Father.
And from our Lord Jesus Christ.
And from our Lord Jesus Christ.
Who gave himself for our sins.
Who gave himself for our sins.
That he might deliver, us from this present
evil world.
According to the will of God and our Father.
Yes.
To whom be glory forever and ever. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Go on.
I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. Which is not another.
Not really another.
But there be some that,
trouble you.
Who would pervert the gospel of Christ.
Who would pervert the gospel of Christ.
But though we
or an angel from heaven
preach any other gospel unto you
that which we have preached unto you,
let him be accursed. And as we said before, so say I now again.
All right.
If any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be accursed.
Thank you. For thought, non-negotiable.
My God.
I don't know, Dewana, there are a few people that I've known down through the years who've been that resolute. Paul here, this is the beginning of his ministry, and God had shown him down in Arabia this truth. In detail. You follow me? Paul was so concerned that he didn't even go back to the Jews, to the apostles. Pretty much that. He wanted to make sure that I got this gospel straight from God. And when he was assured of that, I showed him this. This is it. I don't care what Peter said and John says or nobody else said. I'm holding on to this gospel. And I want you all to understand, you've got to have the same determination. Right. His idea, the one when it's convenient, switching to this and switching to that and this doctrine and that doctrine, God help us. God help us. Now, to begin with, religious involvement and going along with the flow and all this kind of thing, I've been through so many of them. For the last 64 years. A man visited with us today, his dad and I fought this thing way back in 40 years ago. They came up with this one cleansing, and all this, and then eliminating this and eliminating that, and then okay in this and okay in that.
Hello.
The situation. Now here. Paul said, I didn't get this man. I got a direct gift from God. The conviction you have should not come from him. Don't come back to me. But if you got anything at all, it came from God. And you're responsible to God.
Amen.
Don't get mad at me more from some kind of tangent and delayed debate, Brother Hampton, because if you got anything, if you had anything, it'll come from God. Otherwise, it's not. Gabriel come down, I'm still going to change. I don't care about the roof, this, that, and the other. If Gabriel come down, I'm not moving. One inch. What? Come on. Now, you know, I question you whether you ever saw it in the first place. And if you did, it's too bad. If you shift, God help us out, children. Now, listen. All right, what are you saying here? Now, listen. Now, don't even negotiate it. I don't care how they able to lay it out and explain it and compare it to somebody else. Don't even discuss it. That's the reason why God kept me down to the end. What I know is don't talk. I don't have a discussion. Well, let's discuss it. I have a discussion. Listen, when negotiate means to a process carried with parties to reach an agreement. You said I've already reached my agreement. So there's nothing to talk about. There's nothing to talk about. You understand? So they pray that our God is surely now. If you are negotiable, you will lose out with God. Because if you negotiate, you're interested in what they're saying, what they got to offer. You understand? We just gonna go on here, we got to move on. This is Eve. Let's just turn that. Chapter 3, Genesis, verse number 1. Read number 1. All right.
Now the serpent was more subtle
than any beast of the field
which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman,
Yea,
that God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden.
Watch the progression here.
And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden.
Wait a minute, what's going on? God had talked to you already. You want to negotiate with another? Something that you never met before. I don't think you had much experience with all these spirits before because they were not active. Come on with it.
And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree.
Eve, you're negotiating with another spirit here. Wait, now watch, come on here.
But of the fruit of the tree, which is in the midst of the garden, God had said.
Who said it?
God.
And you going to negotiate with somebody else?
Oh, God. My God.
It's only a good thing that she said it. She's not more saint than the Holy Ghost. Nobody's more saint than the Holy Ghost. She's a good saint. Praise God. If God blessing her, if God using her, she's not more here than the Holy Ghost. Come on.
But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God had said, ye shall not eat of it.
Don't touch it. And wait just a moment here. Now, know who you're talking to, Eve. Are you negotiating with somebody else? And God himself, no greater force could have spoken to you. There's not a greater influence that could have been sent your way. Wait just a moment here. Well, my wife said, I should do it. Who? Your wife is not the Holy Ghost, and she don't have it. That's it. You got a double negative here. Come on. Wait a minute. Come on, please.
God had said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it.
Neither shall ye touch it. Yeah. You know what? I tell you, the Lord said, I'll die. Let me tell you something, God. You take this. If you negotiate about a matter that God has shown you, you're interested. You are interested. If you were not interested and if you were not impressed by what he has to offer, what he has to say, you wouldn't even talk about it. You wouldn't even consider it. You wouldn't even consider it. Yeah. I don't get it. Listen. I remember back in 1973 when Don Newton came up with this doctrine. And about maybe half of the stars of the ministers flopped. Old timers who preached this gospel. I mean with power. And got results, as you please. And demanded of the people. Whatever, why? He came up with the scripture, he preferred the scripture here, and began to negotiate. What about this? You know what? I never saw that before. When the sin appeared, that was the first message that was published. When the sin appeared. And you know what? And some other people were there, and he was so impressive that they began to renegotiate. Even communication corrupted manners. That's why you need to yield your faith before God. Sure. And get something directly from God. Amen. And let him know, Lord, come what may.
Yes.
Come what may. It's on the altar. For that I might magnify Christ, a living, a dying. Father, children, I know sometimes when you get tired and your thoughts get kind of fuzzy, and maybe you don't see things as clearly as you want to. You don't have those times. Why? Because we are living by faith, and we are dealing and hinging our hopes on things that we don't see. And we are addicted to rationality. You know what I mean? We can't see and can't explain or don't see reasonable, we just write it off or renegotiate it. Deal with this situation now. Let me tell you something. All these things you say you don't see, one time you did. Give me Romans 1. Give me Romans 1 quickly. Romans 1, please. Romans 1. This is by verse 13.
Now I would not have you ignorant, brethren,
yes,
that oftentimes I purposed to come unto you,
all right,
but was let hear the truth,
all right,
that I might have some fruit among you also,
come on,
even as among other Gentiles.
Yes.
I am a debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians,
all right,
both to the wise and to the unwise.
Sure.
So as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are in Rome also.
Go on.
For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ.
Go on.
For it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth.
All right.
To the Jew first and also to the Greek.
Give me 18.
For the wrath of God,
is revealed from heaven against all unrighteousness,
unrighteous men
who held the truth in unrighteousness.
Because that which may be known of God is manifested in them.
Wait a minute. It's manifested in you. I mean, not in the air. It's manifested. All that. See, you're limited. Your perception is limited. You won't have so much latitude. You follow me? So here. But all that you can know, see, your mind is finite. You follow me? And so that means it cannot perceive it so much. You cannot perceive infinity. Why? Because there's no end to it. And you cannot, like, sometimes I almost maybe got off my mind, maybe almost got me messed up one time. But I'm trying to decide eternity. I'm trying to look. I saw a picture of a can. You have a little cow that, and one did another can. And I'm trying to see the end of it. Well, there's no end. This kept going. And where did God come from? All that kind of crazy stuff. Well, I've been here long, because you might try to find out. You lose your mind. You might have been fortunate now, but I escaped it. But now, there's something you can't know. And you will hide behind your ignorance, that's sad. I can't proclaim it. I don't believe what I can't see. Yes, you do. Remember the illustration I gave? Well, I don't have you to raise your hand, so I'm going to call your person to you and then give you the illustration. I'm going to ask one of my sisters to give me a bottle of pee. And tell you to stick it in this pillow up here. And see how you come out. You don't see no electricity. What color is it? But I tell you what, put your hand on the bottom here. And you do be what you don't see. You say, no, why? You don't see it? Why are you worried about it? Put your hand on it. Hold it. Maybe. So you do believe what you don't see.
Oh my God.
You believe in Africa. Most of you haven't been there. You've been talking about it. We talk about heaven too. Why can't you believe that? Come on.
Because that which may be known of God.
Now, you can only know so much. It's only necessary that you know so much. You don't need to know so much. You understand? Why? Because you can't handle what you got. You know more now than you can negotiate. Come on.
Because that which may be known of God, is manifest in them.
It's manifest in them.
For God hath shown.
It's manifest in you. All that can be known of God is in you. It's manifest in you. Come on.
For God hath shown it unto them.
God hath shown it unto them. Brother Hampton has shown it unto them. Don't get mad at me talking, get over it, and you just told me to get mad at me. But God showed it to you. And then by your testimony, you said at one time, and then when you out on the street, you said, God showed me. God did this to me. God did me. God showed me. You tested me. You testified this morning. What God showed you. Well, wait a minute now. Are you gonna contest what God showed you? Are you gonna revise what God showed you? You said, just shall I live by faith. Well, that means that you live by what God showed you. Faith is not visible. It's practical. It's not visible. You can't see it. You must see the results of it. Come on with it.
Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them.
That which may be known of God is manifest in them.
For God has showed it unto them.
God showed it unto them.
For the invisible.
And nobody proclaimed more than we do what God showed me. God showed me. God showed me that. And I believe I 1/15 of it. Come on.
For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen.
They're clearly seen. God made sure that the visibility would not be questioned because it's clear to see. You understand? And your perceptibility, you can see it. You can't just see it. Come on.
For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen.
Clearly seen.
Being understood by the things that are made.
Come on.
Even his eternal power and Godhead.
Come on.
So that they are without excuse.
You are without excuse. You can't get up before God in the judgment and begin to try to renew the flimsy excuses because they won't prevail. I mean, sort of compare this and compare that and all this kind of thing. It won't be anywhere. It won't be seen anywhere. Come on with it.
Because that when they knew God, they glorified him.
That's what you do with the past tense. When they what?
Knew God.
We wait for them to see God. They were going to get the thing that they see. Now the new God, he's not saying no.
New,
no. But past. What did you make it in the past? Because when you knew him, you were walking by what God showed you. Come on. Come on.
Because that. When they knew God.
They knew God.
They glorified him not as
God. They glorified him not as God.
Neither were thankful. But became vain in their imagination.
The imagination or the real. The imagination was the real because imagination is just the offspring of what you think. You thought it out and now you imagine. You put a body to it. You put a form to it. Are you bringing with me? That you will. Come on.
Because then when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imagination, and their foolish heart was darkened.
Now first, they imagined it. They imagined what it would be like for things that manage. And they negotiated it. Amen. And the law said it, but then they renegotiated it. And now this is our law throughout the land. They imagined it first, and which was not more than a mere curiosity. But now they imagined that curiosity was so compelling that they had to try it realistically. And you know what we have to do. But it all began with imagination. We can watch the children. You know, they hear all this stuff, they see all this stuff, and they begin to, their imagination begin to run wild. And then they begin to get the sensation. What, let's see what it's all about. And then now you're responsible, of course. You're responsible for God. You should say God them. Not only teach it, not only talk about it, but say God them. Don't put them in a predicament where they might. Where they want to, because they imagine early now, because there are so many things now that evil inventions that we did not know about. I can remember in my city, there were maybe only three radios in our community. And when some major event in living together on this one house. And now they got everything that you think of. What? Because they don't have to imagine anymore. They can see it with your little thing, with your being. I'm telling you, it came in the Bible that they're meeting that. Mm-hmm. It's been all this meeting over the phone. Why do you think I'm going to all this advertisement of these bikinis? Are they just an advertisement? And when did you see it? Last week? And you still remember it? It took hold. And relived it? And it developed into something that you thought would never happen again. It will keep happening as long as you're negotiating. Oh yeah, see, the thought of it is too intriguing. It's too strong. You can't handle it. And now, when you get weak and your consecration gets low and you can't handle it, now you're going to begin to imagine it. You follow me? Attitudes, everything else. You follow me? See? Now, somebody maybe did you wrong, an injustice. And you knew that you should be non-retaliatory. You should not overreact to that. But then the enemy revisits you with that incident. And now you begin to just be what she said. Then you had the picture for a moment. And now you're renegotiating what she said here now and what you should have, how you should have reacted to it. I should have told her, wait a minute. When you throw not to react, now you say what you should have done? Now you're cherishing the thought of what you should have done? If you think, down to life, that you say, even as you claim such a qualification, if you had any real problems, if you had any real failures, and because you renegotiated something that you had given up to God.
My God, he's telling trouble.
And justify the difficulties. You follow me? Even you would see what? Because you had decided and firmly that no, this is it. Never the more. And maybe an altar. But now you're negotiating. You're over negotiation. And let me tell you something they want. The reason that the enemy almost always prevails when that renegotiation, because he got so many resources. You find it, what? Giving up the enemies. What I give you is this. I give you this illustration. All right? Turn to, let's go to Chronicles. I got several of them here. Well, let's add Numbers chapter 22, verse 12, 11. Numbers 22, 11. Numbers 22, 11. Read. Numbers.
Behold,
Behold,
there is a come out of Egypt.
There the people come out of Egypt.
Which covereth the face of the earth.
Which covereth the face of the earth.
Come now.
Come now.
Curse me them.
Curse me them.
Peradventure I shall be able to
overcome
them.
This is Balak. This is Balak. He is the king, and he had a great army coming against him. And he had a numerical deficit here. They had more than he had, if I may. And he knew that he was grossly outnumbered. And he knew that shorter than a miracle, he would lose the battle. And that was the consequence of the battle. Come on.
Curse me then. Peradventure I shall be able to overcome them. Now,
and then he knew the record of Balaam, a man of God, because he was prophesied. And he cursed them. If you curse them, then that would diminish them. So it would be able to overcome them. Come on.
And drive them out.
And drive them out.
And God said unto Balaam,
God said unto Balaam,
thou shalt not go with them.
Don't go with them.
Thou shalt not curse the people.
Thou shalt not curse them.
For they are blessed.
They're blessed.
And Balaam rose up in the morning.
Rose up in the morning.
And said unto the princes of Balak, get you into your land. For the Lord refuseth to give me leave. The
Lord said, don't you go with those people, man.
My Lord.
He was speaking clearly. And then he made the announcement. I can't go. God showed me. Don't you go with Roscoe. You saw that spirit the other day. Come on. He removed that divide between your seats. And put it back. And said, relocate. Come on.
It's true anyway.
We did it last time. You know it all. You did it last time. You have enough grace left in your soul to come to your side. Come on.
And the princes of Moab rose up.
The princes of Moab rose up.
And they went unto Balak.
Went unto Balak.
And said,
yeah.
Balaam refuses to come with us.
Balaam. Listen, say, wait a minute. And we cannot possibly prevail if we, as a present situation, persist. So we've got to have some advantage here. And only Balaam had that as far as we know. So you get him, if you curse him for me, and shift and get on our side, then we'll prevail. Come on.
And Balaam. Yet again, princes,
yeah.
More and more honorable than they.
He said his cabinet. I mean, those who worked in his cabinet, honorable men, influential men. Come on with it.
And they came to Balaam said to him,
Thus
says Balak, the son of Zippor, let nothing, I pray thee, hinder thee from coming unto me.
Wait a minute. You have to negotiate with him. And it's up there. We have resources to burn, so don't let nothing hinder you. Whatever he wants, give it to him. There was a fellow in service that I never did like this. They call him, in fact, Frank. And so, and when he would come to town, the women would have to lock up their doors and walk down the street. And then they would go to him. And that was one of the fellows in service. So we're impressed with that power and that he had. He said, he sold his soul to the devil. He had that power. And he was so impressed with that. I said, man, I'm thinking about it. Would you do that? I'm thinking about it. What? And I said to such vehemence that they kind of sight him. You sell your soul for that power, the devil knew what you want. The devil will give you what you want to get your soul. And people are selling their soul for nothing. Because they're disappointed with him. They don't like what somebody said. They don't like what somebody said. Somebody didn't do the one he was saying. Selling your soul for nothing. You could have got a lot more since you were selling anyway. You follow me? Selling that soul would just be privileged of doing something that's forbidden.
nothing, I pray thee, hinder thee from coming unto me.
Don't let me. I got a hard little saint who won't move. I can't move him. So offer them whatever. Empty our resources. I want that soul. Because he's going to give me some trouble. Because he believes God, he's going to stand on where he believes. And he will influence others. So whatever he wants, offer it to him. Well, I'm telling you, you better listen to the prayer of God. The devil had no resources to spare. And then give you whatever you want. But you don't have to do that because most people sell their souls so cheap. You don't have to pay. For a little attitude. For a moment of pleasure. Sell their soul. But let me tell you something, children. When you are free with God, and you choose something that is blatantly wrong, you don't want it.
My Lord, help.
It's something non-refundable. You sell out. Well, Ahab did it, didn't he? He sold himself to do evil. He wanted to accomplish those things which are unlawful and ungodly, unprofitable. And he sold his soul. Well, in fact, he sold his whole self to do evil. Because what the stone that he made able to satisfy his whim, what you know when he wanted, he had a vineyard, and there were deer here, and he just wanted so bad, he got sick. And he had a satanic wife, Jezebel. Man, boy, what's really wrong with this soul? And so, I want that vineyard to get me. It offers so much that it's irresistible. And now, and the enemy will pay your price. You gotta watch it. To get relief. And many times, holy office will not really give relief.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. By the time you might be unresponsive. And you still say it's so. Something that you can't respond to. Ain't the devil dirty?
Mm-hmm.
I sold my soul to this, and I don't even want it. Russ owed me this list. I don't even want you. But you told me, oh, don't you? But too bad now, you know your church teaches that you're one man, one wife, one life. You don't even, you don't fix it now. Devil, he got you now, he preached to you. That's what he did that beforehand. But it wasn't real then, and it's not real now. But now he got you in a bound. You follow me. And pay your price. He pay your price. This fella in the main call, he pays his price. This fella that had power to seduce and to appeal and to capture people's affection. He had the power to walk down the street. For that ability, it was so impressive that there were others that they could feel their soul did it too. And the devil will make a pact with you. See, it's not so blatant, but you'll make it and you can sense it in a measure because you have consent to it. But it's not that seven years old, but sometimes it's that blatant. But you so care away now, you can resist it. I'm going to tell you something. Balaam came that close with his head cupped up with no ice in it. We don't cook it. The angel was standing there and he with his mule. The angel stopped. And he stroked up the angel. I mean, he was driving his ass. So hard. He said, listen, you got to be glad again. Provide all for your head. You know you negotiated what God has shown you. God don't. God says, do not go. And you were persuaded to go. You're up there. And they gave you a price. And that price was all that you needed to take a vacation with, buy a new car, a new house with. And you were so intrigued with the thought of it. So you sold out to God. And now you're trying to enjoy it. Now when you find that you can't enjoy it, you might feel suicidal. Sure, let me just, I won't be able to finish this thing right now. When David was facing battle, a meaningful battle, a critical battle, if you will, and he got a report. Not great unless your vote, if your devotion's not right. If you clap around and ate too much barbecue on me yesterday. And then slept the rest of the day, snored through the night, talking, all that barbecue sauce. Come on. All right. Now listen. And David had not gone out to battle that the king was going to do. See, the king would go out there and kind of regulate the battle. You follow me? All right. When you're in your country, now whatever you do things with your country. You don't have that inspiration. You can't do it just because you said I'll do it. Because you intend to do it. You don't have the inspiration to do it. And you'll submit. I'm gonna tell you. And don't tell me and tell me I don't care, don't your testimony. Let me repeat. Regardless of how strong your testimony is and your resolve, if you're consecrated not where it ought to be, you'll submit.
That's right.
That if the offer is real enough, if it's consequential enough, you do it, you sell out. for something that will last at a moment of man. I'm going to tell you something, because I don't think you're so strong, you're so resolved, that you, I can tell, I don't care what the devil can do. Yeah, you said that when you had inspiration. Peter lives by it too. So I don't care, Lord, not me. I don't care what the rest of the disciples do. Then you know, I'm above them. And I'll go to prison. I'll even die. Take that, Jesus. But Jesus knew that he was testifying above his experience. Don't do that, Savior God. I'm sorry for an impression. I'm trying to impress somebody with some flamboyant testimony. Don't do that. Right. You want to go face it. You want to face it. Then you'll come and shift your head down. Don't take your time. Don't be so sensational in all these testimonies. Because what? Now, the Lord's come in with another situation, and you find out that it's a little more than you thought, and you weren't quite ready for it. Weren't quite ready for it. And now, you dwindles. But you're unable to meet the challenge. That's a pretty difficult scripture. The devil provoked him, a man like David. You read the Psalms. How his stand was, how resolute his stand was. The devil says, come. Let's read that. Over in Chronicle, 1 Chronicle 21, I read here. 1.
And Satan stood up against Israel.
Go on.
And provoked David to number Israel.
All right, go on.
And David said to Joab and to the rulers of the people.
Well, why don't you wait a minute? Go very short. Come on.
Go number Israel.
Go number Israel.
From Beersheba even to Dan.
To Dan.
And bring the number of them to me.
And bring the number of them what?
That I may know it.
I may know it.
And Joab.
Now, what's here? Joab knew David. He knew his history. He knew how he reacted. He knew how he would act in trouble. He prayed for someone. He knew that. And so he said, wait a minute, what's going on here, man? The devil had provoked me to show him how the battle would be lost and all these men and whatnot. He was going to check my people, check out my army. Now this is what Joab said. What did he say?
And Joab answered, the Lord make his people 100 times so many more as
wait a minute. They trust the Lord to you, whatever the case might be. And then, come on, number the people. The Lord make the people what?
More as they be. So many more as they be.
But God gave them to multiply. What's wrong with you? That's not your pattern. And when your inspiration was high, you wouldn't even consider that. Well, how do you know? I'll show you. It's come to 2 Samuel, 1 Samuel 23:3. 1 Samuel 23:3. You let the same God coming your way.
And David's men said unto him,
Behold,
we be afraid here in Judah.
Go on.
How much more then if we come to Keilah against the armies of the Philistines?
Lord, we're afraid. Lord, we got a situation here. We are grossly outnumbered. Come on with it.
Then David inquired of the Lord yet again.
Watch it. He negotiated to begin with, my God, when you face a crisis, you go for the Lord. You would tell a number, if you say God with me, they'll make it. That's majority. I don't care what it is, I don't care how serious it is, I don't care how difficult it is, I don't care how elongated it is, I don't care the source where it comes from. If God's on my side, I can't fail. I will prevail. And that's not a boast, because God is good. And this is, but here now he want to go and see how many men he got. Check his army out. And you know, what difference does it make? See, God told us, no, Moses, I'm going to give you people without number. I can create your own army. And that's what you advocate. God can't do anything, but solve your situation. All that talking and everything else. Wait a minute now. Wait just a minute. And the man reproved him. Wait just a minute. That's not your pattern. You say you trust God for anything. And God don't have the resources at hand. He'll create some resources. For you. Just for you. He'll make something for you. You got a blueprint for your situation. And the resources. You follow me. You better pray hard. because you're going to face the situation. David knew that he was woefully outnumbered, and that if he was short-termed here, he was not numerically situated, then he would perish in the battle. He would go and check his feet out, check his feet out. What's all this excitement? That's not your pattern. I don't care what comes your way. You figure that God would take up the slack. You know, God make the people. Don't care what comes back. 10 people. And I don't care about that one. God with you, and that's what you've done before. You said, God, should I do it? Should I go up, Lord? And you wouldn't do nothing until God says so. And when God says so, I'm going. I don't care if I got the fire. You better pray. Now, you begin to magnify your situation, all this kind of stuff here, panic. You want to. Come on. And see how many resources you got. What you got backing you up. Wait just a minute. What are you depending on? What are your source? You better pray. See, all this talk about faith and all this kind of stuff. You better pray. And won't be reputed as a man of great faith. A woman of great faith. You follow me? But now, when you get in a situation where you have a numerical deficit here, now, you're going to change your mind. Begin to grab some straws here and wonder if I have no, who's on my side. How many I got on my side? That's in my army. Against them. He said, wait just a minute, Joseph. Wait a minute, that's not what you advocated. Oh. When you were in trouble before. You were before God.
Amen.
Inquired of God. And wouldn't do nothing until God answered you. And then grabbed up from one straw. And he went, read a little more there, please.
And Joab answered, the Lord make his people 100 times so many more than they be.
God can multiply them 100-fold. By the hundreds. We just a stroke of the pen. Come on. Mm-hmm.
But my Lord the king, are they not all my Lord's servants?
Are they all? Wait just a minute. They belong to God? Already? So what's all this about? And you're supposed to belong to God. Well, then you have people's prayer. You belong to God, and the sources belong to God, and the wherewithal belong to God. So what's all this about? What's all this excitement about? And guess what, though? But now I want you to notice the consequences. God knew that David knew how to do it, what to do in Christ. Are you following that? Right. And because he messed around, it almost got a whole nation slaughtered by angel. And God said, okay. And wait a minute, he confessed. Well, I'm not going to do that. That's too disturbing. And then I said, wait a minute. And David, when he confessed, what did he say? What did he say? I'm going to let you say it. What did he say when he was confessing about his, or what he did? I have what? What did he do? He didn't get taken by the wife. He didn't rob a bank. What did he do? What? What?
And David
talk
said,
loud so you're afraid.
And David said unto God, I have sinned greatly.
What did he do? What was the great sin? Talk loud, son.
He didn't trust God.
What made it so bad? Because he knew what God was doing, what he had done in the past. Never had that been down. I don't have to matter what. All you, he would hesitate. But Lord, wait a minute. Should I go up? Now if I should go up, then I won't go. I'm not going to myself. I'm not going to my own strength. Well, I know, that's why I'm calling you, because I know I don't have those resources within myself. I'm aware of that.
Amen.
I ain't got nothing to boast about, because I don't have that. But I know you got it. So should I go? I know you have. Should I go? Should I go? And I said, you know, Lord said, hold it. Not this time. You get slaughtered. And just right here. I don't try to go on your own. Because you prevailed last time. See, God has shown you. He will let you go off in a trap here and all this kind of stuff here. He'll let you out there struggling and kicking. He'll tell you not to go. If you know you want to be in his will, just say, he doesn't just say that every time. You know, you don't have to go and perform no miracle every time. 2,000 or 3,000 people like with the stroke of the hand every time. not necessary in this case. But just stay where you are. And then next time, same thing. Lord, should I go? Yep. I'm going to deliver them in your hand. So don't make no difference how many of them I'm going to deliver in your hand. You can do what you want to do with them. I'm going to start them for you. So go ahead. Go ahead. We're not playing no game like you in the last day now. You're going to do some things. This is it. Gosh, how you going to do this? A solid year from there, you know what I'm talking about. This is it. This is it. This is it. I know you're going to get in trouble from something, maybe because this is about America. I did it 10 years ago, 24 years ago. Since America started this mess, we haven't won a war since. There was a time when somebody attacked America, it was suicidal. Probably with them. They had to deal with prayer. Song of prayer. Was and now, 12 and 13 years in a little country over here, we have no resources, and they still can't win. With all our arsenal, all that we have. Father, God help us, I don't know what the message is going to be. I don't know, and I don't know when, but I can assure you it's not going to be long. Why? Because now they've conceded everything. Sodom and Gomorrah was, amen, so we might have a few people. But now we got no states that's that big. What did they allow now? They made an open door for everybody and made it a law. Well, what do you got to work with? I can't work with the Lord. Well, some of them say, let me check out Iowa and New Hampshire. It's all of them the same law. I have nothing to negotiate. And all this meant that about to destroy us right now, he came because of negotiation. When he saw it, and God showed it to them, and then the devil talked to them and renegotiated. So here we are. And if you do it individually, you renegotiate the thing that you gave up. Come on. I mean, something little simple stuff. What's that? What's in your mouth? Or is it just a cool? You gave that up. A cool? Where you going, you're going to be cool. You all never take something. If that's something you need to put back on the altar, why don't you do it? You can't win. You can't be a chill. You can't win. But because you got there by yourself. You want in the past because God was with you. And even what seems to be a win is just putting a scare out. Abandoned on the wound, that won't be victory. You might protect it for a moment with a band-aid, but it's not going to last. You spend the rest of your life trying to prevail, find the handle, put the dots together, and get nowhere. You must. And it ain't going to come to you anyway. So God help us, I have a Holy Ghost, please. Do you want it to be reconsecrated? If you need to put something firmly back on the altar, I want you to do the same. God, that's our concern. That's our concern. That's what God is burning in our heart for. Please, help us out. All right, sir, thank you, God. Even those that were closest to the Lord, Judas, God had taught him. Judas negotiated with those high priests and those that he knew was against him. He was adamant against it, but fully believed in negotiating. He knew he negotiated. He's going to give him up. Because he loved the wages of unrighteousness. And he was He gave his price. Do you have a price? I mean, the word is, if you get too poor, if you do this. You're better if you do this. Good. So you have a price. But I tell you what, the devil got the resources. He got it bad with him. No. Show it, man.
My lord.